Dr. S. Angiyarkanni is working as an assistant professor in Anna University, Chennai. She finished her UG-PG in chemistry in Pondicherry University. She has completed her MPhil at Madras Christian College, Chennai in year 2006 and PhD at Central Leather Research Institute on Surface Science and Polymer Chemistry. Her main areas of research are synthesis and characterization of biosurfactants and the design of nanocarriers for drug delivery studies. She has published more than 7 papers in national and international peer-reviewed journals of high repute. She has presented more than 11 papers in international and national conferences and won Best Oral and Poster Presentation Awards. She has a book chapter in Encyclopedia of Biocolloid and Biointerface Science, 2 volume set chapter 62 on nanocarriers of functional materials from amino acid surfactants. She was awarded DST Women Scientist Grant for a project on designing of biosurfactants. She is life member of Indian Society of Surface Science and Technology. She has 12 years of experience in teaching UG and PG and research.
Welcome to UGC lecture series on polymer science. In applied polymer science paper, we are going to see about adhesives. The contents of today's session are surface energy, sample wetting test. Under this, we are going to see about water break test, dyne marker test, contact angle measurement, and apart from this, some coefficients like spreading coefficient and mechanism of adhesion, thermodynamic work of adhesion, and we'll see some advantages of adhesive joints. We have seen enough introduction regarding surface energy in the previous lectures. To recapitulate, we'll see the definition of surface energy quickly. It goes like this. The surface energy is defined as the work necessary to separate two surfaces beyond the range of forces holding them together and is given in energy per unit area. So, if you look at this surface, the molecules present inside the bulk, that is apart from the surface, are equally balanced by their attractive forces in all the directions. But if you see the molecules near the surface, the attractive forces exerted by the molecules are getting balanced by the molecules present inside the bulk, but above the surface, it is getting not balanced. So, this is the reason for exertion of surface energy by materials. So, now let us see the definition again. The surface energy is defined as the work necessary to separate two surfaces. The energy which are exerted by the molecules present on the surface. So, they'll exert some energy. So, that energy is responsible for holding the surfaces together. Now, surface energy is the energy necessary to separate those two surfaces because each surface will be exerting some energy on them. So, two surfaces beyond the range of the forces holding them together and is given in energy per unit area. So, what is the energy necessary to break the surfaces from each other? Is nothing but the measure of surface energy. Now, let us see how to measure the surface energy of the surface. So, why measuring surface energy for a surface is necessary means it is important for many applications. Mainly for adhesives, the knowledge on surface, the energy of surface is very important for the selection of suitable adhesive. Now, let us see how we can calculate the surface energy of each surface. So, now the surface energy can be characterized using water break test, dyne marker test, contact angle measurements. So, the surface free energy of a solid can be indirectly estimated through water break test, dyne marker test and contact angle measurements. So, now coming to water break test. So, you would have seen surfaces, on some surfaces if you pour water that will adhere very nicely and form a uniform film. But in some surfaces, the water droplets will be remaining as pearl drops. It will not wet the surface properly. So based on this behavior, we can calculate surface energy of the surface. Let us see now. So if you see this, the water break test is go like this. The water break test is a qualitative go or no go test involving the specimen in the form of a flat plate. That is, we are taking the specimen in terms of a flat surface being either immersed in water or water brushed or sprayed onto the surface. If you see at this picture, this is a surface. So for this, we are going to measure the surface free energy. So when you sprinkle water on that, so one part of the surface is getting completely wetted with water, the other part is holding some drops of water on it. It is not completely spread on the surface of the material. It is because this surface is greatly treated and this surface is not treated. Treated in the sense it is cleaned properly. It is having hydrophilic nature and this is having hydrophobic nature. That is the reason why we are having difference in these two areas for the same water. So what it is actually telling? So the plate is then checked to determine the distribution of water on the surface. For example, if you see these two pipes, they are pouring water on that. It is holding the water in terms of a droplet, but this surface is completely spreading water. Then that is whether it remains as a continuous film indicating good wettability or forms distinct droplets indicating poor water wettability. So here this is having poor wettability and this is having good water wettability, means the surface energy of this surface is more when compared to this. So by this water break test, we can tentatively determine what kind of a surface it is, whether it is a high energy surface or a low energy surface. In the case of high energy surface, water will wet the surface properly and form a uniform film. But in the case of low energy surfaces, water droplets will distinctly appear on the surface, will not properly wet the surface. Next, we'll go to the still more particular value for a surface energy using another test called as Dyne marker test. So Dyne pen test for assessing the surface energy of plastic films, it is a semi quantitative test. So it will tell you actually the value. Water break test is a qualitative test that will tell you what kind of quality of the film is, whether it is a high energy film or a low energy film. But Dyne marker test is a semi quantitative test that will give you the value of surface energy appropriately. Dyne marker is containing a series of mixtures of formamide and 2-ethoxyethanol. So these are two chemicals which are having different surface energies. They are mixed in a proper proportion in such a way that they are incrementally increasing surface tension or applied to the plastic or varnished surface using a solution soaked cotton wool bud, that is just like your earbud, until a mixture is found which is just wet the surface. So the concept of Dyne marker test goes like this. Actually, we are having two chemicals. One is a formamide and the other one is 2-ethoxyethanol. They are differing in their surface tension values, but the mixtures were done to get appropriate values of surface tension of liquids. So what we will do is, we will make the homogeneous mixture of the solution and using a earbud, a cotton bud, touching the solution, we will using the cotton bud, we will make mark on the surface. So if the surface is wetted properly, that is equivalent to that of surface tension of the liquid with which you are soaked in. So that will give you, so if you measure the surface tension of the liquid mixture, that is the surface free energy of the surface for which we are measuring surface energy. So now this is judged visually by examining for breakup of the applied liquid into drops. Let us see this picture. So if you see this, you can see the same marker pen we are making. I am making lines. So in this, one part of the surface is getting wetted properly by the ink. It is forming a uniform layer, but in the other part, it is broken into small droplets. So what is the reason for this kind of behavior? In this film, one part of the film is treated, I mean it is washed properly and treated, the other one is not treated properly, it is hydrophobic in nature. So when I make marking on the film, so the surface tension of the ink is matching with this portion of the film, but this is not matching with this portion of the film, that's why it is not able to give a proper continuous film in this side, but here we are getting a proper line. So when the surface free energy of the film is matching with the surface tension of the liquid what we are using to make the line, will indirectly tell you what is the surface free energy of the film. So let us see another. So the lines will be looking like this only. So if the surface tension of the liquid matches with the surface free energy of the surface, the line will be uniform like this. But if the surface free energy of the film is not matching with the surface free energy of the ink, it will be like this. It will lead to broken droplets like this. It cannot give you a continuous line. So for example, if you see here, so in this I am taking two dye marker pens. The surface tension of this is set as 38 and this says 44. How we can fix the values is just by changing the composition of the liquids what we are using, that is the formamide and ethoxyethanol. So now this film is having surface free energy of 38. I am making lines with 38 and 44. If you see, the one which is equivalent to that of surface energy is forming continuous line, the other one is giving discontinued droplets. It couldn't give a proper line. Similarly, if you want to measure the surface free, actually we are doing in trial and error measurements for calculating the surface free energy of the film. I am taking a film whose surface free energy is not known to me, then I can take a set of pens with different surface free energies. So I can make lines on them with each pen. The one which is giving proper uniform line on the film is selected as the surface free energy of the film, because once the surface free energy of the film and the surface tension of the liquid is matched, then you can get a continuous film. This is some indirect way of measuring surface free energy of the films. So, dyne solutions, the solution what we are using for making lines on the films, that is called as dyne marker test, and the solutions are called as dyne solutions. So, now dyne solutions are available in sets of different surface tensions, and systematic use can quickly provide an estimate of surface free energy. You don't need to wait for some advanced instruments or something like that. It is readily available. Take a set of pens, make lines on the surfaces for which you want to measure the surface free energy. Immediately you will get the surface free energy value. It is a very instant test. And then the critical surface tension of the surface is approximated by the surface tension of that particular solution. A higher dyne value indicates a more wettable surface. Now you can relate this to our water break test. So if it is having very good wettability, you should go for the pens containing more value of surface tension. The another type of measuring surface free energy is by measuring their contact angle. So you know very well what is contact angle. The determination of contact angle at the solid liquid phase boundary is one of the most sensitive methods for determining the surface energy of solid materials. So where the contact is coming, actually we are making a droplet on the surface. So if you put a droplet on the surface and measure the angle made by the water droplet on the surface, so that will tell you what is the contact angle of that surface. So still we are narrowing down, we are going deeper into the sensitivity of the value. Now contact angle between liquid drops and surfaces can be measured directly from the angle formed at the contact between the liquid and the flat surface. So now let us see how to do this experiment. Now measurements can be made using manual goniometer. So this is the instrument used for measuring contact angle, an inexpensive instrument. The drop is illuminated from behind and viewed through a lens focused on the drop. Let us see the figure which is showing the contact angle measurement, which is a goniometer. Just look at this figure in which this is the substrate. Substrate in the sense, this is the surface for which we are going to measure the contact angle. So, on the surface, water droplet is made. How to make a water droplet? We have to make a controlled size of water droplet using a syringe. So on this we are making a droplet. This is the droplet made, and syringe can be lowered with a precision towards the sample. Every time we will be delivering fixed volume of the droplet to have a uniform value. And then we have a camera here, and this droplet will be illuminated from this side. We are giving light from this side and we are viewing the droplet from this side. This is a CCD camera, and then this is connected to a computer from which we can analyze the image and you can find out the contact angle. And now, contact angle test in which we are going to have a reference line is manually positioned to read the contact angle. That is, if you see this, the line made by the sample surface is the reference line. So, the drop may also be projected onto a screen to view the contact angle, and then low cost handheld instruments are available. So, this is a very easy method, and based on the digital camera technology where the drop is imaged onto a built-in LCD screen using a CCD chip to produce an image that is easier to measure than the traditional magnifying eyepiece instrument. Just by looking at the droplet and measuring the contact angle is manually difficult. So, if you leave for some time, what will happen? So, the drop may collapse and that angle you cannot measure properly. So, for that we have a camera. We will capture the image as soon as the droplet is delivered onto the surface. Then the image is processed with softwares. Let us see this now. You just see this picture. So, the contact angle image will be like this. Since we are using magnifying lens, it will be magnified like this, and this is captured using a LCD camera, and then we have a surface. On this we have a reference line. This can be manually drawn in the software, and we have this. This is the droplet, and if you draw a line which is touching the droplet, that will give you the contact angle of liquid made on the surface. Just this is the schematic picture of contact angle. This is the solid surface for which you have to measure the surface free energy, and if this is the droplet, we can make a line here. So, the angle made by the line with the substrate will give you the contact angle. So, the static contact angle can be measured by observation of a drop of a test liquid on a solid substrate. Now, if you see the contact angle vary with the nature of the surface. This we have already said, if the surface is having low energy, that will make a high angle. If you see this, the water droplet didn't have any contact with the surface. So, the contact angle is 180 degree for a non-wetting surface. So, the angle made by the droplet over the line is nothing but the same straight line. So, the angle is 180 degree. It may be equivalent to that of water droplets on a lotus leaf. It will be like this. So, the angle made by the water droplet on the leaf is 180 degrees. And then these surfaces are called as non-wetting surfaces. But in the case of wetting surfaces, the contact angle is less than 90 degrees. So, if you see this, this is an acute angle. So, the angle is less than 90. This is 90. This is 90. So, this is less than 90. This is around 45 degrees. So, these surfaces are called as wetting surfaces. So, if you see this, the droplets are not much bigger in size. They form half wetted on the surface. These surfaces are called as wetting surfaces. And in the case of perfect wetting surfaces, for example, if you put one water droplet on a tissue paper, you cannot see the droplet at all on the surface. There is no angle made. So if you see this, the water droplet will be completely spread on the surface. So, this scenario is called as a perfect wetting scenario. In this case, there is no angle at all. It is a 0 degree contact angle surface. So, now from this contact angle of a surface, we can find out spreading coefficient of the surface. Now, what is spreading coefficient? Spreading coefficient is the work done in spreading one liquid over a unit area of another, that is equal to the surface tension of the stationary liquid minus the surface tension of the spreading liquid. Because we are bothered only about the surface tension of the which is created between the liquid and the solid. So, we are subtracting the surface tension of the spreading liquid as such, then minus the interfacial tension between the liquids. So, if you see here, equilibrium spreading coefficient, that is S equilibrium, is to classify the different wetting states. So, can be calculated from surface tension of solid vapor, which is nothing but the surface tension of solid only, minus surface tension of solid liquid, which is nothing but the interfacial tension between them, plus surface tension of liquid and vapor. So, when you add this, so you will get the value like this, that is surface tension of liquid vapor into cos theta equivalent, that is the surface tension what we are measuring from the surface, minus 1. So, spreading coefficient in equilibrium, the above measures the difference between the surface free energy and its value in the case of complete wetting. So, in the case of complete wetting, the angle is going to be 0. So, cos theta will become 1. So, this will become 0. The spreading coefficient is calculated like this. The general spreading coefficient at equilibrium, if it is lesser than or equal to 0, only in the case of complete wetting. Because only in the case of complete wetting, cos theta, cos 0 will become 1. So, 1 minus 1 will become 0 and this term will get cancelled. So, when a drop of liquid first encounters a surface, it is far from the equilibrium state. So, when a drop of liquid is to make some angle on the surface, it is first encounters the surface, then it is far from the equilibrium state. An initial spreading coefficient may be defined as initial spreading coefficient, which is nothing but Si is equal to surface tension gamma S0 minus gamma SL, which is nothing but the surface tension of solid liquid interface plus surface tension of liquid vapor interface. So, when surface tension of solid at the initial stage is the surface tension of a dry solid substrate, which is nothing but the surface free energy we wanted to calculate. So, if initial surface coefficient of solid is less than 0, the drop will have a finite contact angle, and at initial stage theta I, that is the contact angle made as soon as the drop is delivered on the surface, and preferred to remain in a partial wetting state. On the other hand, if spreading coefficient in the initial stage is more than 0, the drop will tend to spread out and wet the surface. So, now coming to the analysis of spreading coefficient, an analysis of the adsorption equation shows that in general, initial is always greater than equivalent, because when you leave a drop on the surface, first it will make an angle, then after some time it will start spreading on the surface. So, once it has started establishing the equilibrium, it will create an equilibrium surface tension, which is nothing but the spreading coefficient at equilibrium. So, that is after establishing the equilibrium between the surface, which is the measure we want. And then this implies whenever initial surface spreading coefficient is less than 0, this ensures that equilibrium also is less than 0, because it cannot be lesser than that. And then nothing definite can be said about the sign of equilibrium spreading coefficient if initial spreading coefficient is greater than 0. Now, coming to mechanism of adhesion. So, to function as an adhesive, a polymer must be able to take on the characteristics of both liquid and a solid, and coalescing in the case of waterborne latex adhesives. So, that is it should the polymer should form a film on the surface, that is actually the mechanism of adhesion. So, now we'll see some more properties for the mechanism of adhesion. So, in this, the ability to properly wet a given surface depends on two aspects. One is a favorable thermodynamic energy aspect, that encourage intimate contact of the adhesive and substrate being bonded, or sufficient time and molecular mobility for the adhesive to confirm and wet the surface. So, it should have a favorable thermodynamic surface free energy. That is, as we said already, the adhesive should have a favorable thermodynamic surface free energy with the surface. That is the reason why we are measuring the surface free energy of a solid which is to be adhered. And then it should have a sufficient time and molecular mobility. So, to have a good contact and to have properties like mechanical interlocking and other things apart from adhesion to confirm and to wet the surface. So, increasing pressure, temperature or time of bonding may accelerate this later kinetic processes. So, if the adhesive and adherent surfaces are incompatible thermodynamically, if it is not energetically favored, so what will happen? The poor bonding will often result because of the difficulty of achieving intimate contact between adhesive and the substrate. So, some secondary bonding forces are also important in the case of mechanism of adhesion. This we have seen elaborately in the previous lectures. So, let us quickly view about the secondary bonding forces. So, the secondary bonding forces between the atoms in close proximity are able to account for much adhesion we observe. These bonds are referred to as dispersion or van der Waals forces, and breaking these molecular attractions would require relatively small amounts of energy. So, typically of the order of several tens of millijoule per meter square. Apart from that, we have primary bonding forces, so which are nothing but the which can exist in certain situations, and although inherently stronger and more durable, this mode of adhesion is less widespread. These are primary chemical bonds. This we have already seen, the one which are making covalent bonds which are much stronger, they will make even the surfaces in one. And apart from this, we have also seen about molecular interdiffusion, electrical double layers, mechanical interlocking. So, molecular interdiffusion is nothing but in the case of rubber cement, the two surfaces, when they brought together, they allow interdiffusion to occur. That is nothing but tackiness will occur, the make the surfaces to disappear. And in the case of electrical double layer, it can develop across the bond plane, leading to electrostatic attraction because of the oppositely charged surfaces. And then mechanical interlocking, this is by the intrusion of the adhesive in creases and pores of the surface. Then mechanical roughening can remove weakly bonded surface layers and increase the available bond area as well. And then the next one is thermodynamic work of adhesion. What is thermodynamic work of adhesion? The one which is energetically favoring the bond formation. So, breaking the attractive forces between the atoms of the adhesive and the substrate give rise to small energies known as thermodynamic work of adhesion. And it is measured in tens of millijoule per meter square. So, if you see thermodynamic work of adhesion in shortly or in easily, you can describe thermodynamic work of adhesion is nothing but the amount of energy needed to break the surface. So, which is nothing but the opposite of the amount of energy needed to form the surface. On the other hand, when a real adhesive joints are mechanically broken, fracture energies of several kilojoules per meter squares are often measured. But if you see thermodynamic work of adhesion, they are measured in terms of millijoule per meter square, but while breaking we need kilojoule per meter square. The later energies are referred to as practical adhesion, because it is not only theoretically what we are telling for adhesion, there are so many other factors involved in which increases the adhesive force to make the surface much stronger, and are typically several orders of magnitude larger. In this case, you would have seen three orders are larger than the thermodynamic surface energy. So, now coming to advantages of adhesive. Why we have to go for an adhesive in spite of so many other techniques? This we have seen elaborately. Let us see a quick review of that. In an automobile, passenger safety depends on substantial energy dissipation in a crush zone achieved because of the adhesive bonds force and the metallic components to deform in such a way that the metal dissipates large amount of plastic energy. So this is again giving the passenger a comfort, giving a comfort of the dissipation, energy dissipation, instead of giving a great vibrational shock. It is taking up the shock in the case of adhesive joints, which is not possible in the case of mechanical adhesion. The large values of practical adhesion energies for high quality modern adhesive provide significant resistance to debonding growth. So there is lot of variations which resist the debonding growth. Adhesive formulators have developed a number of toughening techniques that have been successfully incorporated into commercial adhesives, improving their resistance to impact and fatigue loading. So now let us see the summary of the lecture. So now we have seen wettability and spreading, the surface free energy with which we have started in, then the contact angle, the measuring techniques such as sample wetting test, contact angle test, sample wetting test, we have seen water break test and dye marker test, and contact angle measurement, and following contact angle measurement, how we can find out spreading coefficient, what are the mechanism of adhesion, a quick review, and thermodynamic work of adhesion, what the definition of that, and then advantages of adhesives. So the possible questions from this portion of the lecture are: explain the surface energy and the methods to determine the surface energy. What is spreading coefficient? Often there is the definition of spreading coefficient is important, and how it is related to surface energy. And then explain mechanism of adhesion. What is thermodynamic work of adhesion? How it can be calculated? And then what are the advantages of adhesive joints over mechanical adhesion? We can say about the mechanical shock proof plastic joints, because it can withdraw some kind of vibrational dissipation. Thank you.